Let us pray. O Almighty God, who pours out on all who desire it the spirit of grace and of supplication, deliver us when we draw near to you from coldness of heart and wanderings of mind, that with steadfast thoughts and kindled affections we may worship you in spirit and in truth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Let your continual mercy, O Lord, cleanse and defend your church. And because it cannot continue in safety without your help, protect and govern it always by your goodness. through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Epistle to the Ephesians. I, therefore, the prisoner in the Lord, beg you to lead a life worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing one another in love, making every effort to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. But each of us was given grace according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it is said, when he ascended on high, he made captivity itself a captive. He gave gifts to his people. When it says he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended to the lower parts of the earth? He who descended is the same one who ascended far above all the heavens, so that he might fill all things. The gifts he gave were that some would be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers, to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until all of us come to the unity in faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to maturity, to the measure of the full stature of Christ. We must no longer be children tossed to and fro and blown about by every wind of doctrine, by people's trickery, by their craftiness in deceitful scheming. But speaking the truth in love, we must grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by every ligament and with which it is equipped, as each part is working properly, promotes the body's growth in building itself up in love. The word of the Lord.
We will read Psalm 78, remaining seated responsibly by half verse. So he commanded the clouds above. He rained down manna upon them to eat. So mortals ate the bread of angels. He caused the east wind to blow in the heavens. He rained down flesh upon them like dust. He let it fall in the midst of their camp. So they ate and were well filled.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. The next day, when the people who remained after the feeding of the 5,000 saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they themselves got into the boats and went to Capernaum looking for Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, "Rabbi, when did you come here?" Jesus answered them, "Very truly I tell you, you are looking for me not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. Do not work for the food that perishes, but for the food that endures for eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For it is on him that God the Father has set his seal." Then they said to him, "What must we do to perform the good works of God?" Jesus answered them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent." So they said to him, "What sign are you going to give us then, so that we may see it and believe you? What work are you performing? Our ancestors ate manna in the wilderness. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Then Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it was not Moses who gave you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is that which comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." They said to him, "Sir, give us this bread always." And Jesus said to them, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. Be known to us in the breaking of bread, and do not then depart. Savior, abide with us and spread thy table in our hearts. Amen. I have been thinking about bread all week long. I started thinking about when I first started baking bread, and I think I must have been 7 or 8. So when I think of bread, I think of flour all over the kitchen counter. I think of dough under my fingernails and flour on my dress or whatever I had on, and probably all over the floor. I think of the loaves of bread I made every Saturday morning when my children were young, and the biscuits for special occasions that we would stuff with Smithfield ham. And I think about making communion bread at St. Margaret's and at St. Albans with the children because we used their real bread like we do at the jazz service. And the children would make the bread and they would put their initials in the bread and the date of their birthday. And every Sunday on their birthday, we would use the loaf of bread that they had made. But I think, too, of romantic picnics with a fresh loaf of bread and a bottle of, well, maybe good wine, maybe pretty cheap wine. And I think of the most wonderful bread that came out of the ovens on the streets in Tbilisi, Georgia. Hot, flat bread that tasted so good. I have been looking for that bread ever since. And the loaf of warm bread served with a little bowl of salt in Ukraine, which was brought out to welcome any guest. So there are all kinds of images that come to my mind about bread. And I suppose that none of us here have really experienced hunger. That is, any more than when we skip a meal or when we fast for a day. We're more likely to be addicted to food, to be preoccupied with it, to hoard it, to let it be a source of intense conflict, of guilt, an identity crisis, than to experience real hunger. And while some of us suffer from high cholesterol, obesity, food allergies, anorexia, or bulimia, much of the rest of the world struggles to get enough food to satisfy for a day. And that's why, and I have to stop and make an advertisement here. On the 20th of September, mark your calendars, we're going to be at St. Catherine's School and take part in Stop Hunger Now program as our Sunday morning service. We're not going to be here because of the race, but we're going to do something very creative and very different and something that will make a difference in the world. So when I think about bread, I think about all of these things. But my sense is that even without the simultaneous presence of starving people and the overabundance that we enjoy, Jesus would find our society's symbolic reliance on food as an invisible chain binding us to a source that is empty, of true nourishment and empty of sustenance. Whatever the supply of food at the market or the overabundance in our kitchens, whatever our dependence on food, it cannot be the source of our spiritual life. And yet, the most consistent image of heaven in Scripture is food, is the banquet. People gathered around a groaning board, celebrating and eating together. People around the world, where they can and when they can, however they can, gather around a table with as much food as they can put on it, food that groans with the lavishness that is possible for them at that time. The key to this apparent inconsistency, I think, can be found in the words of the reading for the Gospel today, the Gospel of John, with its image of Jesus as the bread of life, the only bread, the only thing that satisfies and fills us. This image of eating, of fasting, the bread of heaven, be known to us, Lord Jesus, in the breaking of the bread, expresses that life-giving relationship that Jesus invited his followers to share. I am the bread of life, he said. It's graphic language, but we're used to it. We hear some form of it every Sunday. But the truth is that Jesus was the only one who taught them about life and fed them when they were hungry. And their experience of the risen Christ was that he was the very source of abundant life. We don't have a problem with that language. But those who heard Jesus speak about it were outraged. The idea of eating flesh and drinking wine. Think about how horrified we were a couple of years ago when we learned that our ancestors at Jamestown ate their fellow settlers. We were outraged at the idea. And I suspect most of us have done everything we could to put it out of our minds, so I apologize for bringing it up again. But the outrage that we felt was similar to the outrage that Jesus' companions would have felt. Eat flesh? No. But this powerful metaphor, vivid metaphor, was used to express the experience of belief that Jesus is the Christ of God. The truth of the metaphor cannot be fully explained, but in the experience of those who believe in Jesus, Christ is the bread to those who hunger, water to those who thirst, light to those lost in darkness, life to those who are dying. To do the work of God is to believe in Christ, to feed on Him so that we absorb His teaching, His character, His mind, His ways of being through His body and His blood. It is to eat the body, the bread of heaven, to chew on it, to let it become part of our very being, to let the light of life of Christ become part of us, part of who we are, part of our identity, and to abide in us so that it becomes our strength and our very life, freeing us to be the people God created us to be. The language of this passage in John's Gospel has the themes of passion, of Eucharist, of kingdom of heaven. And every part of the mystery of Christ is contained in every part of it. The shadow of the cross falls on the incarnation. The marks of the nails are present in the risen Christ, like the flour, the salt, the water, the yeast, all mixed together in that dough, and every ingredient seems to be part of the whole. So you cannot say, I want the piece of bread that doesn't have any gluten, or I want the piece of bread that doesn't have any salt, or I want the piece of bread that doesn't have any liquid, any milk or water in it. The incarnation, the passion, the resurrection of Christ are a unity. They are inseparable. It is in the Eucharist that the life-giving Spirit of Christ is received. John's Gospel goes on to say, He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. The Eucharist is the means by which those who have received the Holy Spirit are renewed in the Spirit as they journey through life. What the body and blood of Jesus do for the soul is not temporary, it is lasting. The food which fills our shelves and our refrigerators, the dough on the counter and under my fingernails and on the floor, cannot become the source of spiritual life for us. It is the holy food and drink that fill us with God's grace to go into the world in peace and love, bringing strength to the faint, giving courage to the weak, healing the sick, and working urgently for justice. The Lord who sustains life invites us to faith, to adventure, to take risks, and to participate in God's crazy dream of love. Every day before she went out to work with the poorest in India's slums, to bathe and put on fresh clothing for those who were dying, Mother Teresa of Calcutta received the Eucharist, food for the journey of offering mercy to the needy. You and I are invited as Christians as Christians have been down through the ages to receive the body and the blood of Christ for strength and for renewal, to make us one body, one in Christ, to serve the world in Christ's name, to do God's work and to believe and thus to be instruments of God's peace. Sunday by Sunday, for almost 2,000 years, the story of Jesus' incarnation, the crucifixion, the resurrection, has been repeated and responded to. This is my body, which is given for you. This is my blood, which is shed for you. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take and eat them in remembrance that Christ died for you. Christians keep on eating the bread and sharing the cup in isolated mountain villages, in underground house churches, in prison cells, in crowded rooms in filthy cities, in near empty village churches and royal palaces, great cathedrals and parish churches like St. James's. And the words echo, "This is my body. This is my blood." Jesus, as the bread of life, is a powerful image of God who entered our world, who shared our humanity fully, who suffered our brokenness and shared our joy in order that our lives could be whole. In his body and blood, you and I are sustained for the journey, and by his presence and become part of his body, we share that with the world in service for the world. The truth is that even the most eloquent theologian has difficulty explaining this idea of the bread of life, because it's a mystery. God's passionate love for us is a mystery. It is not provable, but it is believable. It is that in which we can put all of our trust. As I watch young children come up to the altar rail to be fed, there is a joy on their faces, there is a spring in their step, there is an excitement that, frankly, most of us don't have. I had one child that came up with his hands out like this saying, "I want to piece of Jesus." And one child said at the jazz mass a couple of weeks ago, "That Jesus was really yummy." And there was another child who I will never forget said, "I want one of those lifesavers." Children get it in ways that we don't, because we want the explanation. We want the proof. What they want is Jesus. I invite you today to come to the altar with your heart open as well as your hands, allowing your heart to hear the words, "The body of Christ, the bread of heaven," or "The body of Christ, keep you in everlasting life." And then, my friends, the only thing left to do is to say, "Amen."
Standing, let us reaffirm our faith in the ancient words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please kneel as you're able, and let us open our hearts to God. In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and works.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world, especially those who work for peace in the Middle East and throughout the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel, and all who seek the truth.
For all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God and His church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your loving kindness, be upon them.
Who put their trust in you.
We pray for the sick and those in need, especially John Calvin Barnard, Lee Bowles, Muriel Christensen, Whit Clement, Marguerite Ellett, Alexis Feria, Elizabeth Herring, George King, Ashley Bloomer Kolitz, John Porter, Ruth Ann Sawyer, Brick Smith, Strother Smith, Lynn Stott, Betty Whitehurst, Brenda, and Patrick. We ask for your care and guidance for those serving on upcoming missions, especially the St. James's Richmond Mission Team, who will serve the week of August 10th through 14th. We give thanks for the lives and ministries of all who celebrate their birthday today, especially Charlotte Tribble, Margie Barton, Scott Henry, Mason Baylor, Daryl Ricard, Benjamin Cronley, and George Jones. We give thanks for the births of Olivia and Ruby Sewell, daughters of Lee and Nate Sewell, and granddaughters of Brooke and Bob Taylor, who were born this week. We ask your blessing on the marriage of Alice Mason Tyler Kilpatrick and Robert Martin Crutcher, who were married here yesterday. And in the sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life, we remember Claire Sykes, who died last week, and Edward Earl Lucado Luckadoo, in whose memory the altar flowers are given.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Good morning, St. James's. Wonderful to be with all of you here today, and a special welcome to any newcomers or visitors who are here today. We're so glad you're here, and I invite you to introduce yourself to one of the clergy or anyone and make yourself known, and join us also after the service outside for some refreshments that will be on the sidewalk. And you may also, if you're new and visiting, fill out a pew card so that we have a little bit more information and can follow up with you. I'd like to thank our musicians this morning, Casey, our guest organist, and the Vassar family singers. Thank you all for your gifts today. For any young adults out there, I would like to invite all of you to be with us on August 23rd at the home of the Abplanalps, Mary Beth and Chris, for a summer social. The details are in your Sunday chimes, and we'll hope to have a great turnout of young adults. And here at St. James's, we define that as early 20s to early 40s. So if you fall somewhere in there, please do come and join us on the 23rd for some fun together. And as Caroline mentioned in her sermon on September 20th, mark your calendars, we will not be worshiping here. We will be worshiping at St. Catherine's in their gym. And lots of details are in your Sunday chimes, but we'll need some help with that. And we're also asking people to sign up ahead of time online so we have an idea of how many people to expect that day. But please just go ahead and mark your calendar for that day, September 20th. Worshiping and celebrating servant ministry on Servant Sunday. There are lots of other announcements in your chimes, so please read them. And finally, Nancy Warman and I would like to invite all of the participants of the Richmond Outreach Mission to come forward. They are will be starting their mission trip right here in our own city on August 10th, but we're going to go ahead and do the blessing today. So please come forward. Johnny Martin, Kyle Martin, Mary Alice Dirks, Cammie Ferber, Cheryl Hartman, Ed Hartman, Brian Hoffman, Judy Philpott, Pierce Rucker, Andy Smith. Right up here. So we have actually two different groups. One group will be working at Project Homes, and the other group will be working at Virginia Supportive Housing. And all of them will be serving folks in our city who are in need, and it's going to be a wonderful week. So thank you all for giving of your time and your energy. And why don't we have a prayer and a blessing for them? Let us pray. God of grace, be with these your servants who give generously to love and serve others. We thank you for their willingness to be doers of the word, to go out into the city in which they reside to make a difference. Thank you for the blessing that they will be to others and the blessings that they will receive from others. Watch over them and bless them in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you all. And walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and thanks for grace.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks to you, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O Father, we remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with James and all your saints we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Breaking bread, breaking bread. We are
We'd like to welcome forward to the altar rail any who are celebrating birthdays or anniversaries for a blessing. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage, love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Thank you.
in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.